Hi, and welcome to Healthy Living. I'm Dr. Donald Pelto, and I'm here with Lorri Ducharme from Prestige Nails in Webster, Massachusetts. Lorri, thank you for joining us here at Healthy Living.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
You're welcome. We've been talking on the phone probably for the last 6 months or a year, and we have patients kind of that go back and forth as a podiatrist into a nail salon. And I'd like to start talking a little bit about the background of your profession. What does it take to become a nail technician, and what is the schooling?
In Massachusetts, currently it's 100 hours to get a license to practice manicuring. Mm-hmm. Which is a very short amount of time.
And is that book practice, or is it hands-on, or is it a combination of
both? It's a combination of both. So if you went full-time in 2.5 weeks, you could be given a license, and there you go. You can go open your own nail salon.
Really? Mm-hmm. And where's the nearest school? Is there one in Worcester here?
There are a few in the area. Marlboro, Worcester, outside of the Boston area, you'd have to travel a little bit.
Okay.
There are some cosmetology schools. You know, some of the girls go to full cosmetology program, and you learn a small portion of nails in the cosmetology. But as far as manicuring only, there's a handful of nails only schools.
They focus just on that. Great. And how about, let's say you finish that in your career? I know there's continuing education, and if you want to get some advanced training, how does that work?
It takes a little bit of research. There's more available now than there was 15 years ago. There are some online programs. One of them is MediNail Learning Center, and that's a podiatrist-backed program that was written and designed by a podiatrist for nail technicians to elevate their education, their learning, how to better recognize, recommend, and refer, build relationships with podiatrists. Because the need is so great, podiatrists are seeing the bad things, I guess, for better lack of a word, coming out of nail salons.
Yeah.
And we'd rather send them to the doctor. So this training teaches you way more than you ever will learn in school. And there's another program, a nationwide program called NASP, North American School of Podology. They're a Canadian company, so they've modified their curriculum to teach some of the advanced techniques here in the United States without stepping outside your scope of practice.
Yeah.
So there are a few offerings out there, but it takes a nail tech a little bit of time to, you know, you got to do your research, because this information is, it's still slow to get out there.
Now for you specifically, I know you did the MediNails.
I did MediNails.
Why, and you rotated in my office. And why did you do that? Why did you find have a calling to do that?
I saw the need, the change within my own clientele in health concerns and, you know, the physical, seeing the physical breakdown of changes in the nails, changes in foot care in general, and I wanted to make sure I was offering the best experience I could, the safest experience, and giving my clients the correct information when they came in with something that was a little questionable or outside the scope of my practice. So I loved working in your office, and I learned so much from a nail tech, not saying I'm gonna, you know, I want to become a medical, you know, assistant in a podiatry practice, but from the cosmetic end of our industry, you know, learning as much as I could on the podiatry side was so useful, because now I have educated conversations with my clients.
Perfect.
Because I'm able to recognize and understand a lot more about conditions.
Yeah. And so after having that additional training, in that program, how has that changed how you practice or how you treat your patients now and your clients?
Again, clients are calling because I work at higher standards of infection control than what is required by our state agency.
Let's talk a little bit. What's required?
From our state agency, the regulations and guidelines are 30 plus years old, and it's very difficult, because there is a lot of political background to that, to get anything changed within the state board guidelines, and it's quite the process, and we're still currently waiting 2+ years for the newest guidelines to be released. So I understand that, and they're very loosely written to leave a lot of room for interpretation. But right now, our state only says we need, you know, in Massachusetts, 100 hours of schooling, and to disinfect our tools in a proper, and I'll call it barbicide, because it is promoted in the book. And but a lot of times that is not mixed correctly. The consumer doesn't know what's the proper protocol. The use of reusing files and buffers. on clients is very dangerous. We cause tiny microtrauma, cuts in the skin and the nails, often just by filing, you know, with a board, and a tiny little slice can happen, or using electric file. Again, you're taking away delicate tissue around the surrounding nail, the cuticle and the hypenechium and the epenechium. All of that gets scuffed up and surfacely removed, which now leads to, you know, the possibility of infections later on down the road, as well as even with a pedicure tub. A lot of people don't understand. You need to not shave 24 hours prior to getting a pedicure, because you remove. Oh, we try to explain all the time how important that is, especially using the Whirlpool spa tubs. One tiny little nick in your skin can potentially
get a cellulitis or an infection.
Oh, bad. And it's out there. And unfortunately, our industry has received a lot of negative media over the years, which is why we're trying to change that all over, across the board, and elevate the entire industry beyond what the basic standards set by many state boards are. So come up here, it's, if you're practicing here, that's okay. You know, you're following the state guidelines, and that's okay. But we choose to go here and elevate above the state standards for infection control by using an autoclave or a dry heat sterilizer.
So that's what we're going to show now a picture of. So explain this picture that we're looking at.
This particular one is a dry heat sterilizer, and you would take your metal tools, wash them, dry them, bag them, and put them in this sterilizer, and it runs for a 60-minute cycle. So it's a very long cycle. And there's heating coils inside there that reach a very high temperature. So it does kill everything, and you can spore test those to be sure that they're operating efficiently. Another sterilizer is a steam sterilizer, high pressure steam sterilization.
Is that an autoclave?
That's an autoclave. That's exactly the same thing that the podiatrists and dentists and doctors use. And that also steam sterilizes, so it's high pressure steam. And that is a similar setup, using the water, and you run a, they're shorter cycles though. Like in the nail industry, they recommend a 25-minute cycle. And then there's usually a dry cycle, which is a wonderful bonus. So the implements come out, there's bags, the pouches tell you that they've reached the correct level.
You have a little line on them.
Yeah, yeah. So that's one difference. It's a verifiable way for us to prove to the consumer that these have been sterilized, not just sitting in blue liquid on somebody's nail table.
Yeah, and that's what we want to go to and talk about now. It, those that are watching here, maybe they're not near Webster, maybe they're far away. If they're looking at what should they look at when they go to a nail salon? I'm sure it would be great if they had one of these autoclaves and they see them pull out sterile pouches.
Right.
That may be the case, may not be the case.
There's a lot of misinformation out there. I think for me, and I try to educate every single client that comes into our salon, generally, read up on your on the salon that you want to visit. See what kind of reviews are written, because there is the social media can be used for a lot of information nowadays. And general appearance of the salon when you walk in, is it smell? That's usually the number one complaint a lot of clients will say is like, oh my gosh, that it stinks so bad. And that's a sign that maybe there isn't like proper ventilation in place.
Okay.
And that's important for our health, the nail tech's health, as well as the client's health.
Certainly.
And then cleanliness of the nail or foot care area. You know, is their table cluttered? Does it look dusty and dirty, full of nail clippings? Does the table towel, is it a fresh table towel that's placed, you know, down? I ask every single one of my clients to wash their hands before they sit down at my table. Whereas many places, it's either at the end or not asked at all.
Yeah, and just to get any surface bacteria that might be on the hand.
Number one. And the pedicure areas, same thing. You don't want nail clippings. Has the spa tub been properly disinfected, especially if they still use the Whirlpool? A lot of salons, if they use a liner, that's actually a really good sign. One fresh disposable liner per client. And the implements, if they're coming out with things in pouches, you can ask, oh, do you use a autoclave or a dry sterilizer? Unfortunately, there is one misconception that they're using the UV boxes as their sterilizers.
Yeah, we'll show a picture of that now.
Yeah, okay. that's how they're
so what's
sold
a UV
as.
Box?
It's a UV light box that the new regs, when they come out for the state, they're actually going to be banned here in Massachusetts mm-hmm. because they're being misused. They're just holding boxes for things that have been properly disinfected.
Okay.
So they use UV bulbs in them. But we know UV does not kill. It does not sterilize. And the bulbs are dirty and dusty. Mm-hmm. So a lot of places are putting implements in packages and putting them in the UV sterilizers. That's what we've been hearing, you know, a lot of dangerous situations, and that's what we're trying to educate the client, like ask more questions, you
Correct.
Know, say, hey, is that a blue light box? Because the blue light box is not an adequate form of sterilization.
Yeah. So for all those that are watching here, really ask questions. If you're going to mm-hmm. a salon, you can ask them questions. It's fine. It's going to protect you. It's going to protect the salon. And you should try to find a place that's reputable and go around to find. Because I have a lot of people that come in with infections or with problems. And it's not sometimes they can just happen.
Oh, exactly.
But these are some precautions that you can take. What are some of the common misconceptions that people have about nail salons?
I think just assuming that, you know, they're following all the protocol.
One nail salon's the same as the other,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Oh, a nail salon's a nail salon in the mall or
right.
next a couple
exactly.
blocks away, they're all the same.
They're not, you know, I think when we ask a lot of information of our clients, I take an intake form, mm-hmm. I want to know some general health questions. You know, in many cases, you're just, you know, walking in and asked to pick a color off the wall. There's very little communication, so that I think a lot of clients don't realize there are nail techs and nail salons like us out there that, you know, might not be as visible as in a strip mall, but
Correct.
We are out there. And just be a little bit more mindful. The communication is key, and I know that's a big situation, you know, a problem with some of the salons mm-hmm. because there is no communication.
There's a language barrier sometimes.
And you don't know if you're seeing things, drawers being opened and nail files or dirty nail brushes being pulled out and anything looks used. Like I tell my clients, that's not the right place for you.
Yeah. And I find sometimes we have patients that come in and they may get an ingrown toenail and they may say, I went to get a pedicure for a wedding and then they came in with an ingrown toenail. Who's to say? I don't know if it was the pedicure, but these types of things happen. It's nice to find a good place to go where you're always going to the same person, where you develop that relationship, there's that trust, mm-hmm. and they're going to guide you to get the help that you need in case you need it.
Exactly.
What are some of the, we have another little slide here we're gonna put up to talk about what are some of the safe and the not so safe things that you can use in the salon that they should be using. Can you explain this slide a little bit?
Some of the tools and implements, especially for safely reducing callus on the bottoms of the feet or the sides of the great toes, would be not the grater, the cheese grater type.
So the upper right-hand corner?
Upper right-hand corner. Those are actually not safe and in many places have been banned for use because they're very, have you ever nicked your finger like shredding cheese?
Yeah, I shred a lot of things and I cut myself, yeah.
All the time, so
carrots.
It's very dangerous. Yeah. And the bottom one is the Credo blade and that actually, believe it or not, there are many places that hide them and they pull them out and they shave clients' calluses. And
you can't do that anymore.
No, that is not good for us. So safer options would be, you know, the paper style abrasives.
Almost like a sandpaper.
Exactly. And that's a home care. Like I even retail those to my clients to keep up in between, you know, caring for the heels. And the wonderful product is the Angel Feet File. And that is, it's actually diamond cut, but it will not cut skin. Mm-hmm. I love it. And it was created by the gentleman who made the floorboard for the space shuttle.
Hmm.
So very good product. So you definitely want to stick with something that's not scary looking, that's going to be used on the bottom of your feet.
Now, how about some of these? I get this question all the time. These two popular ones that are out there. One is a nail trimmer that has something, they say it's for diabetics, and it just kind of trims the nail. And there's another one that has a little callus.
So kind like the
Pedic,
similar to the
like
Pedic.
What are your thoughts on those?
I mean, professionally, I would never pick one up in my salon, mm-hmm. but I have clients that will use those for home care. And again, if they overuse, you could take that sandpaper file and over buff your foot and still like cause a burn or take too much callus down. So when my clients ask about them, I'm like, you know, anything in moderation, but you got to be careful because there's still a sharp bladed surface on that.
Yeah.
So that's my take on that.
And what I say to the patients, especially if you're diabetic and you have a condition called neuropathy where you don't feel, you could just buff until you have a sore there mm-hmm. or a cut and you may not know it. So if you have a lack of sensation or poor blood flow or diabetes, just be really careful. I don't recommend using those things at home. If you have a really thick callus, these won't cut the mustard. they won't. You have to get them professionally shaved down by a podiatrist or by someone. Mm-hmm. It probably shouldn't be your nail salon. They should shave, because you need a razor blade to shave them down. And a lot of people need to come in and they're on weight-bearing surfaces, meaning mm-hmm. that's where he has a lot of pressure, and it needs to be trimmed down. Otherwise, these big calluses, and I'll show you a picture right here of a big callus, and it has some black area underneath it, that's blood. And that blood, if you keep walking on that callus, it could develop into a sore or an ulcer. And those are the things that you ultimately want to avoid having. And I see people are very good from nail salons sending them over if they're mm-hmm. in that condition.
Oh,
you
yeah.
don't want to mess with that.
I've seen and sent, definitely.
Yeah, but there are certain conditions I find they're not sent all the time. And the two most common ones I'd like you to talk about would be like nail fungus and ingrown toenails. When do you send them? When do you not send them?
So ingrowns, if they're not red, inflamed, or infected
yep.
looking.
Perfect.
I call them involuted nails. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's how I was taught.
Yeah.
And I know that keeping the debris field clean, you know, and teaching my clients to, when they get out of the shower, just pull down gently on the sides of the
yep.
skin and with
Me
a towel,
too.
Just
mm-hmm.
sort of clean that area out and trimming it more often. I might have them come every 3 weeks and just keep it cleaned up. So if as
Perfect.
Long as it's healthy and not infected looking or really painful, that's when I send them to the doctor. But I think managing it, you know, before it gets to that point on my end, at the nail technician's end, we've been able to successfully have, you know, very healthy toenails
yeah.
and not have any issues.
And I find the nail technicians are very good at they trim the callus out the side
right.
and they trim
right.
the nail out. And for the majority of the people, it's fine. Once it gets red and painful, that's when they send them, and we can do there's a permanent procedure that can be done for that if needed. And how about, you know, we're going to start going talk a little bit about things that might look like fungus or are fungus
mm-hmm.
and when they can be treated, when they can't be treated on your end of things or even on our end of things. Because some of our patients, we're seeing them, they're 70, 60 years old. They might not be a good candidate for the treatment for nail fungus. How
right.
do you treat nail fungus, or when do you treat it, or what are some of the options?
I think if it looks very extreme, and you brought up the age, and that's a good point. So I think some of the younger clients, 20s, 30s, and it looks questionable, they're the ones that I recommend they go see treatment, because I know oral and laser and topical have been successful.
Mm-hmm.
The geriatric clients, many
the older
of them,
patients, yep.
Unfortunately are not gonna, they're not in good health to be able to take an oral, and they're not gonna really take the time. Many of them can't reach their feet or see their feet to put
topicals.
The topicals on. So in our program, it is a fine line of being able to care for the client without stepping outside your scope of practice, but we can safely reduce them, you know, with either buffing gently down to remove
them a little
some
thinner.
Thickened
mm-hmm.
And just keep them cleaned and shortened. So that's one of those really fine lines, at least in the program that we're taught, because I sterilize and everything's disposable and we have ventilation right at the site where
yeah,
I am working with
mm-hmm.
this debris field. And you know, the filings and proper mask usage is really important. So that's my take on it.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
of my advanced training.
Yeah, a lot of patients they choose to see a nail technician for nail care
mm-hmm.
when they have a fungus. For us, basically, because they come in, they ask, "Oh, doctor, are you going to do the pedicure?" I said, "Yeah, I'll do the pedicure," but they paint them much better. So if they are really low risk,
mm-hmm.
it's going to look a lot better for the females if they go. See some type of a nail technician, especially if the insurance doesn't cover it, because that's a big question. Some insurances cover, normally if you have diabetes, but if you don't and you don't have any other symptoms, a lot of times they don't cover it. Now we're going to go on and show some examples. So we have quite a few examples here, so we'll go through them, and I'd like you to tell us kind of the story.
Sure.
This one, to me, just looking at it, it kind of looks like a fungus, but I think we talked before, it wasn't.
It was not. She did see a dermatologist, and this is overuse and overabuse of acrylic nail product. So this is when the nail is thinned out greatly with a electric file when
mm-hmm.
they do the fills, and also oversaturating the brush with the monomer or using an acid primer. They go from brush to nail, it pools, it runs, and it sits at the hypenechium, and eventually, you know, it causes that kind of breakdown and irritation. And over time, our bodies, with anything, I think any chemical that we're exposed to on a regular basis, we develop a sensitivity to it.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's oftentimes what happens. So this was a case, she did see a dermatologist, and she was given some treatment creams to use. And it's embarrassing because, you know, oftentimes they're not seeing what's underneath the acrylic or the polish, or they're going for their fills, and they're, the tech kind of brushes through all that.
Yeah.
You know, when they speak up, like, well, why do my fingertips, you know, any kind of sign of redness, itchy, irritation, that's allergy. That means you need to remove the existing product from the nail, cut everything back, and send them to a dermatologist.
Yeah. So we're not diagnosing or treating this, but if something looks like this, you should be seeing a dermatologist.
Absolutely. She was referred to a dermatologist.
Yeah, perfect. Let's go to the next slide here.
And there's where separation of the nail plate from the nail bed. So over time, what happened is the nails, there's nothing to attach to. The irritation, the damage to the nail bed itself started to occur. Allergy, fingertips were swollen and irritated. And it was best to just remove all her product.
Yeah, I had a similar patient with a similar nail, and the way it was treated, you took off all the product, and then you used starting a very strong topical steroid, and eventually it all kind of went away.
Cleared up.
I think it was oral and a topical with the dermatologist.
And a client like this typically is then afraid to go back to a salon to get a service. So again, it kind of reflects back on the industry itself that, this happened in a nail salon. Look what they did to my nails.
And just so you know, these can go back to looking normal.
Oh, absolutely.
This is a possible. Let's go to the next slide here.
So these are things I question. You know, I take photographs of instances, and I'm fortunate enough that I can send a little photograph to Dr. Pelto.
Yeah,
just ask. Sometimes I found asking questions about shoes, biomechanics, you know, what could be going on, rubbing, you know, arthritis. So in instances like this where I'm not sure, so even through my questioning of the client, then I'm recommending them to see the doc.
And when they would come in, I would take a sample of this nail to verify, is it a fungus or is it not? This and the other ones that look like they're lifted.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we can go to the next slide here.
This is a younger diabetic client who has her high nail folds. And it was just, she came to see me, and we could see some irritation starting, redness, swelling. So basically, during that treatment that day, I did not touch that toenail, nor the next digit, and left those alone, and sent her right away to the podiatrist because she is diabetic.
Yes. So if those that know what they're looking at, the glove is touching on the inside, on the sides of the nail. It's the one closest to the second toe, and it's ingrown, a little bit red, and a little bit of infection.
Yes.
And what that needs basically is to be numbed up, and we remove a little side of the nail. But along with that as well, there's some nail lifting where the nail's lifted off.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I find that lifting can continue to lift because of the water that gets in there, and it just continues.
Mm-hmm.
But if it is treated, you can remove that nail edge and it'll eventually grow out normal.
And she did see a podiatrist, and it was treated. And they did the
matrixectomy.
I can never say that correctly. And she returned with permission, and we do her pedicures, and it's grown back beautifully, and there's no more issues because now we kind of make sure we keep up with cleaning that side.
Yeah.
And because she was diabetic, it was so much more important that she see a doctor right away.
Correct.
Like, go immediately to the doctor.
Next slide here.
This is a fellow nail technician in another state. We share a lot of stories and pictures with each other. So this client was cleared by a podiatrist. She was topical and oral medicated, but that sometimes with an aging client, it never goes away.
Mm-hmm.
You'll never see an improvement. So the product that we can apply as nail technicians after receiving extensive training to use the product correctly, it's called LCN Barefoot Gel, and it's a thin resin that bonds to the keratin, if there's any keratin present, and it's cured under an LED light, and we could wear that for months at a time. We have them come back depending on how much nail we have to work with when we first do the build out, anywhere from 2 to 6 months in between treatments. And this woman went from those toenails to now look at the beautiful end result.
Yeah, she's probably crying because she can
wear sandals now.
Most
women do, just from personal experience, from the clients that I've been able to do this product application on, are in tears.
Yeah, this is great for those people. Maybe you can do a topical, but for a topical for nails like that, it's not going to clear it up. Or it's going to take a long time.
So there is another podiatrist that likes to at least give a laser treatment right before we do this, this treatment. Do a laser, and then in 3 months, we remove the product and do another laser.
You could do
treatment.
Laser, you could do
So that's oral. Kind of the talk within our MediNeal group of getting a podiatrist to just do the laser treatment and do it a few times, you know, every 3 to 6 months.
Yeah, yeah, that's a great way.
This picture is both of her great toes were treated by a podiatrist due to chronic ingrowns, and this is what all the nail that has grown back. She's a nurse. She wears the nursing clogs on her feet a lot. I think a lot of her, personally, some of the thickened nail was just, you know, biomechanic buildup, you know, the rubbing. The rubbing. So we were able to build her beautiful toenails, and she comes in every 3 months, and she loves that she can wear sandals again.
Perfect. Is there a picture of this one, the next, is there a picture?
Yeah, I think the
Let's
next one.
Let's go to the
one.
Next one here.
That's her other great toe.
And then the next picture.
And there's after the product application.
Look at that.
And
I think there's one more
put,
the other one.
Yep, there is another one. That's the other great toe.
So that's the resin that kind of
goes
on there
and hardens.
That is the
resin, right?
Looks normal.
And it cures under the LED light. And then end result, polish and happy feet. And then I don't need to see her again, you know, 3 months. Mm-hmm. And she'll come back in for maintenance.
So in 3 months, it'll grow out about 2 or 3 millimeters.
Yep.
Do you refill that in or do you redo the nail?
I think it depends on, again, the instance of how well the product is wearing. If you see it's maybe not attached as well as it should, then we remove it by e-filing it off and reapplying fresh product. But if it's still attached and the nail grows a little bit slower, I think, you know, it depends on the individual, on the growth rate.
Yeah.
Then I'm just refilling her. I'm just rebalancing it out. And there is a home care product that is recommended by this company that has
an antifungal
antifungal, antimicrobial, and it's getting her to use it every day. And that's part of the commitment. And this is a tremendous upgraded service in the salon for us.
Yeah.
Like, women will pay anything.
Well, yeah, because your confidence goes up when your nails look good.
Oh my gosh.
Now, how long? I guess, how long? Is it take an hour, half hour? How long does it take to do a procedure like
just
this?
I book her for about 45 minutes. I'll do her pedicure on another day. So I literally just do the LCN service that day and repolish her toenails. And
so two nails and four, because it's two. It's the other ones are just polished.
Right,
it's the two,
correct.
The two big nails for
45 minutes.
Okay, that takes a while. So that's.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's usually chit-chatting. It's, you know,
but that
a lot
looks,
that goes along with it.
Yeah, that looks amazing.
Thank you.
Any other pictures there? I don't know if there's any more.
It was another client. Mm-hmm. Also received, that was an injury. Somebody stepped on her toe and the nail, like finally when it shed, after the damaged nail grew off, it shed. And we were able to rebuild it.
I think there's
probably she was very happy.
And after there, another.
We can do a lot with that product.
Yeah.
It's opened up a lot of doors in the salon for us.
We have a similar one, which we don't do. Which basically we don't do. We could do. You guys can make it look beautiful.
Right.
So I could make it look like that nice pink part, but then after that, someone else has to paint it anyway.
Exactly.
So I find a lot of times
you
doing all of that just works better.
And I'm sure as a doctor, I mean, you don't want to be doing the cosmetic end of things. You want the surgical end of things.
Yeah,
so this is where I love that the relationships are building between podiatrists and nail technicians.
Yeah,
you know, because it's a lot more than just doing pretty nails, which is the fun part. But, you know, pedicures and foot issues are not going anywhere.
Correct.
And we put a lot of miles on our feet every day. So I really try to educate my clients on how to better care for their feet.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. Well, thank you so much, Lorri, for coming over and talking.
Thank you for having me.
Any last tips for patients that you would have for them? You gave us that good one. Anything else you want to tell them that you tell all your patients?
Don't bring your own tools to the salon. That's not
a pet
the
peeve?
Answer either.
Yeah, because they're still not sterile. So you need a place that sterilizes
and,
them.
Yeah, don't let them put them in boxes and bags. That's probably the number one pet peeve from a nail tech's end, because that is incorrect information, and that's not something that I would encourage my clients to do, is to ever bring their own implements.
Perfect.
And ask questions.
Great. I think asking questions is great. Well, thank you. Once again, we have Lorri Ducharme from Webster, and she's with Prestige Nails. And thank you for talking with us today at Healthy Living.